there is so much time you have to make an entry, to file paperwork with customs after the merchandise arrives to the United States. And depending on whether there is a national day or the holiday, that is being extended. Or or maybe shortened. So imagine something falls on Saturday. You think, okay, it falls on Saturday, so it's due next Monday. But let's say Mother's Day is on Saturday, so customs has day off on Friday. Just changing the fact pattern. That means your deadline is shortened. So duty, such a thing as a duty payment. Usually you have to pay duties by a certain day. Well, what if that day is a holiday? When do you pay the duties? In 3 days, or you want to pay them before? So even though this may seem like just pro forma, right? Just a holiday. This really has a further meaning. So when I started this class, I said that a lot of the things that are being asked on the exam are being really incorporated. They're not really testing you. Customs examiners will rarely ask you, is Christmas Day, do customs work on a Christmas Day, right? But what they will likely to ask you is, merchandise arrives, you clear it, and you need to pay duties within 10 days, and the 10th day falls on Christmas Day. When are the duties due? The day before Christmas or the day after Christmas? This is a question. This is more interesting, right? So I think this is what we're trying to get to. So again, where's my pen? Again, so let's start building the foundation and move on. So hours of business. So again, just like with as you can see now, there is a good example. Hours of business, right, is all in caps, and then general rule is in small caps. That means that there is a smaller idea within a whole big idea. So all these topics in small caps, they will refer back to the hours of business or business hours. But what they will also do is they describe the subtopic. And as you will often see, a lot of rules are prone with exceptions. And some of them have so many exceptions, they just eat the rule. And the rule itself becomes an exception. So let's go to the business hours. So customs office must be open for business, again, for general business. I sometimes call customs officials in GFK around 8 o'clock. I get emails around 7:30. Yes, they come in early. They may not stick to this, but usually the idea is to have a whole day, starts at 8:30 and ends at 5. Now, some of the students who run ahead of the game and read on, they will see a lot of questions which look like they're asking 8:30 to 5 p.m. And they would be right, because there is another similar rule for a particular type of merchandise which has restrictions for it being admitted into the United States. In other words, quota merchandise. And they have what's called quota hours, as we shall later learn. And those quota hours, they look like that, but they are not. I believe they are 8:30 to 8 o'clock to 4, something like that. So keep in mind that it's general CBV business hours and nothing else. So when you see questions on the exam, pay attention to this magic word, general. And then assign 8:30 to 5. This is one of the customs have asked this type of questions on this before, and this is really easy questions to get. So of course, we discuss weekends and we discuss holidays, right? But what about something such as local conditions? My favorite one is a snow day in Miami. They do call, and customer examiners have asked them a question. They, in the fact pattern, they say, there is a snow day. What does a snow day stand for? By the way, I'm not having this in my outline, I don't think so. So if I throw some words out of the blue and you may not recollect them, you may want to write them out on the sidelines. But snow day refers to, does not have to refer to snow, it can refer to any kind of obscure weather condition, hurricane, tornado, tsunami, earthquake, which causes logistical difficulties of getting to the office. Of course, if you can't get to the office, you cannot be open for business. If you cannot be open for business, you can't really clear freight, unless you're doing electronic filing with servers located elsewhere. Of course, these hours are flexible, so depending on the traffic, depending on the volume, you may need to cut down the number of employees and therefore number of hours. State and local holidays do not count. So if there is a holiday in New York City, if there is a holiday in New York State, which is New York State observes, but not the federal, not Western nation observe, then the customs will not observe. They'll show up for work, even though the state employees may not. Services outside of CBP office. So those are the hours. So inspections, checking the merchandise, seizing the merchandise. Usually customs will travel between those hours. Is that always the case? No. Because if it's outside of the regular hours, it's okay too, but it has to be done with the overtime pay, and it's probably premium pay. So if a lot of companies such as FedEx, such as DHL, they employ customs officials who clear their freight in their own premises. And because they run under the logo business moves 24 hours, 7 days, something like that, or business moves non-stop or always on time, to really put the meaning to these words, when the freight comes in on Friday night, customs is closed, they need to clear it and deliver it, they really have to pay overtime to the customs officer who sits there, inspects and clears the freight right on the spot. They usually have the office for that customs officer in their facility also. And those facilities are often called express consignment facilities. So again, notice we are talking about the labels, right? Those labels, and what are we trying to do? We're trying to be librarians. We're trying to navigate through the labels. So even if the label doesn't seem what it says, you really have to look at the elements. And the next label is very famous label, very popular, comes around all the time, Customs Territory of the United States. So, and it comes down, if I'm not sure how many of you like geography, but I asked this question. Let's see if someone can give me. Sometimes people don't give me that answer. How many states are in the Union? 50 states. Someone whispered. Almost, yes, 50 states. Yes, last time I checked, there are 50 states. Alaska and Hawaii are outliers, 48 states on the mainland. But for customs purposes, there is such a notion called customs territory. And customs territory encompasses other lands, two more lands, which we need to be aware of. One of them is Puerto Rico. there's a little island in the Caribbean. And another one is District of Columbia. So you often see Barack Obama speaking something if you watch television, for those of you that have television or online. He is usually sitting in District of Columbia because that's where the White House is. District, anyone been to DC? Anyone seen DC license plates roaming the streets of New York City? Pay attention to the license plate sometimes, because if you see the DC, Washington DC license plate, it will say taxation without representation. And what are they talking about? Well, we live in a democratic government, so we pay taxes. In return, we elect officials who supposedly represent us. Whether that's true in fact or not, many people will argue and disagree on many things, but at least that's the theory. That theory does not work in Washington, D.C., because Washington, D.C. is run by Congress. You elect Congress, states elect congressmen. And states elect senators. There are two senators per state, and I believe 430 or 50 congressmen from the other states. So you this is called the Congress, right? So you have the Senate and the House of Representatives. And those people allocate budget to run courts in Washington, D.C., and run police services, etc. But people who live in D.C., they don't get to elect who represents them. And this is why they adopted the Sprout label on their license plate, taxation without representation. If you don't believe me, Google it. Next. So, of course, that meaning has huge implications as far as the customs duty that you have to pay, the labeling requirement, and the movement of goods from other places. And those other places may be also U.S. territories, but they may not be customs territory. So after the World War II, United States acquired a lot of islands in the Pacific following the defeat of Japan. So such islands such as Guam, Marshall, Mariana, all those came into the United States possession as a World War II aftermath and defeat of Japanese. Most of the people who live there, they are natives or U.S. military. American Samoa, Palau, well, what about U.S. Virgin Islands? They belong to the United States as opposed to the British Virgin Islands that belong to the Great Britain. So they're considered as possessions, or to use appropriate name, the insular possessions of the United States. And they are not, these lists are not customs territory of the United States, which means that once you bring something in from those places in the United States, you have to pay duty. You have to go through the customs procedures. The customs procedures may be a little bit less strict, but nevertheless, you are subject because you are entering customs territory of the United States. So you may say, well, just a moment, how about when I enter something to the U.S. Virgin Islands, when I bring something to the U.S. Virgin Islands, aren't I bringing goods into the United States, so-called made in the United States? Well, and yes and no, for customs purposes, no, you are not bringing into a customs territory, but because U.S. Virgin Islands have their own tariff code, which is separate from the customs code which we studied. I'm not even sure if U.S. Virgin Islands have customs broker with them. So yeah, that's That's one of the things that you need to be mindful of. And here comes one example as custom example. And those ones, when you see this label quiz break, it doesn't mean you woke up and take a break. That means we break from the general text and we take a look at the substantive question, the actual question that was asked by customs examiners from the past. I am usually not changing anything unless the law changes. If the law changes, such as, for example, the duty rate changed. Everything else stayed the same, but the duty rate changed. I changed the duty rate. And if it affects answer, I change the answer, but otherwise I leave the context intact. So we shall be seeing much more of those as we journey through the customs broker exam world. But this one is one of the easy ones. They ask, which of the following is within customs territory of the United States? And they give you the laundry list. And of course, knowing what is not within customs territory of the United States just as good as knowing what is within the customs territory of the United States. So they give you A, B, C, D as U.S. possessions, and then they give you one island in the Caribbean, which happens to be within the United States, within the customs territory of the United States, along with other non-state, which is District of Columbia. So you pick that one and you move on, and you got yourself a point. Easy one. The next label is a little bit more challenging. And we will be seeing, we will be coming back to that label more and more because it has a lot of important implications. The major implication is because the date of entry, that label, if you can properly assign that label, you will know when to pay duties, when to submit paperwork, and how to avoid penalties. And a lot of customs questions, they revolve around these duties, penalties, the due dates, proper submission, mitigated damages, etc., etc. They all revolve around the date of entry. Duty rates are determined for most of the merchandise according to the date of entry. So this is very important thing. So why am I saying it's a label? Because common sense, and by common sense I'm alluding to is, I'm hoping many of you agree, is when you look at just the word date of entry, when stuff enters, it's date of entry. I mean, to me it makes sense, right? It enters, great. That's the date of entry. So it comes in to the United States, it enters the United States on January 1st. January 1st is the date of entry. Cool. The problem is you have to depart from the labels because you can tweak it around and really change it or postpone it depending on the circumstances. And what those circumstances are, well, we're gonna go through some of them in a moment, but before I dive into that, let me go back. So stuff enters. Let's say I'm shipping a container from Shanghai to Los Angeles. It enters the United States. Well, when does it enter? When does it crosses the international waters? Just let's look at so let's say this is a Los Angeles, LA. So ship comes in. When do international waters start? I believe, is it 200 miles off the coast? So it enters the United States when it crosses the international waters and goes into the national waters? Or when it comes to the port vicinity.